Merry Christmas. There we go. I see that you guys all weathered the storm. Praise Jesus. Praise that name forever, right? Ushers are here, and so we are going to receive the tithe and offering. Let's go ahead and bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you so much for the gift that you have given us. You have given us the greatest gift ever given to all mankind, past, present, and future, and that is your Son, and his name is Jesus. Help us to be in that same spirit of giving, not only tomorrow when we're with family and friends, but tonight through our offering and our tithes. Use this, Lord, so that other people will have the opportunity to receive you as the greatest gift ever given. And again, his name is Jesus. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Couple announcements. I'm going to go quick. Number one, 412 Youth Group. So sorry that we had to cancel last night, but we are going to have our Christmas party / New Year's Eve party this coming Friday, December 30th. We're going to still have a Yankee swap. We're going to have gifts. We're going to have food. We're going to have a chance to win a hoverboard, which I tried out with my daughter's help. I did not die. I'm still here. Pastor Darlene and Randy thought it was funny, but yet they didn't get on it. I did. So you guys can still maybe win that. If you bring a friend, you'll be entered in to win. That's 6th grade to 12th grade. You guys are welcome to come 6:30 to 8:30 this coming Friday. Second announcement is we are beginning a 21 days of prayer Sunday, January 1st, starting at midnight. We're going to kick it off with 24 hours of prayer. You may have seen the easel out there with time slots, half hour time slots. We need everybody to fill that in because we all need to be praying for 24 hours. That's day one. Then you guys probably saw this on your chair. You'll see day one, 24 hours. Then you'll see day two, day three, and so on, all the way to 21 days where we'll have a topic each day to be in unity praying for. And so we're excited for what God's going to do during this time. Sign up. Also, I forgot to tell you that when you sign up, you also have a reminder card. So you'll put your time slot for the 24-hour time that you choose, a half hour. You can put it on your mirror in the bathroom. You can put it on the refrigerator. You can put it in your car, wherever you're going to remember to pray. So let's do this. Let's just get excited for what God's going to do in the new year. What a way to start the new year, by the way. So before Pastor comes and gives his message, we're going to watch a video. I think you will like it. And in fact, I know you'll love it. So here we go.
Abby, what do you like most about Christmas?
Presents, playing with my friends.
And who brings you those presents?
Santa.
What's the best part of Christmas for you?
Santa.
Santa's pretty cool, right? Does he bring you toys?
Yeah.
What?
He brings a lot of toys.
Hey, do you like Christmas?
Yes.
What's the best Christmas you ever had?
I don't know.
What's the best Christmas gift you ever got?
Please.
Hey, I'm here with Kendall. Kendall, what's your name?
Kendall.
Awesome. We're on the same page, aren't we?
Yeah.
What is your best part of Christmas?
I love hearing that Jesus is born.
It's because we celebrate that Jesus died for us. And he was his birth, right?
Jesus being born.
What kind of food do you like to eat at Christmas?
My mom would just have sugar stuff for breakfast.
Oh, like cookies and things?
Yeah.
But how about Christmas? What do you like about Christmas?
I like when you get to play in the snow and also get presents.
You get presents? And what if you could have anything you wanted this year, what would you want?
A God set and a Woody set.
A God set and a Woody set. I don't know what those are, but they sound really, really awesome. So I hope you get a God set and a Woody set. Listen, what's your best part of Christmas?
Getting gifts.
What do you want for Christmas?
I don't really know. A stuffed animal pet.
A stuffed animal? How cool is that?
I do want a remote control car.
What do you want for Christmas this year?
A shelf, a new shelf, like red.
A shelf? You want a red shelf?
Yeah, white red. I really want a horse set.
What do you want for this year's Christmas?
Legos.
You like Legos? Rock on. I love Legos. What do you love building out of Legos?
Minecraft. Snow.
You just become not a friend. But anyways, we love snow. Who's cooler, Pastor Ken or Santa?
Santa.
You.
So you have Jesus and Santa and Pastor Ken here. Which one's the coolest?
Jesus.
You know, I have to agree with you. I think it's Jesus, Pastor Ken, and Santa, right?
Yes.
Jesus, then Santa, then Pastor Ken, and Benji, and then Santa.
So who's the coolest, Jesus, Santa, or Pastor Ken?
Jesus.
Good answer. Awesome, Slotney 5, man. What if you could tell Jesus anything, because it's his birthday, right? What would you tell Jesus?
Happy birthday.
That is so cool. Do you want to sing happy birthday?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jesus. Happy birthday to you.
Well, hey, listen. Look at all those wonderful people out there and say, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
You want to say Merry Christmas to your parents?
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Pastor's awesome.
Pastor's awesome.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
There's nothing better than messing with the minds of little kids. It brings me great joy. It reminds me of the story of these two little boys, and they're spending the Christmas Eve at Grandma's house, and she goes, go to bed and don't forget to say your prayers. And one little boy screams out from his room, dear God, please give me a bicycle for Christmas. And the other boy says, what are you yelling for? God's not deaf. And he goes, no, but Grandma is. Okay, I'm going to see how smart you are, right? Here we go. What do you call a kid who doesn't believe in Santa? A rebel without a clause. All right, what do you call Santa if he also lives in the South Pole? Bipolar. Oh, come on. All right, you'll get this one. I know you'll get this one. What do you call people who are afraid of Santa? Claustrophobic. All right. Okay. And just for you ladies, why did the snow woman want a divorce? Because her husband was a total flake. Oh, man. All right. We got another little video. I want to show you this video. This is a classic, right? Schultz, who does Charlie Brown, this is just a classic because he really nails the meaning of Christmas. And what I want you to do is, as you watch Linus describe what Christmas is. Now, Linus is the one that always carries a security blanket, right? Wherever he goes, he's got a security blanket. And I want you to watch specifically when he timed when Linus lets go of his blanket.
I guess you were right, Linus. I shouldn't have picked this little tree. Everything I do turns into a disaster. I guess I really don't know what Christmas is all about. Isn't there anyone who knows what Christmas is all about?
Sure, Charlie Brown. I can tell you what Christmas is all about. Lights, please.
And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not. For behold, I bring you tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God, and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. That's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown.
Wasn't that a great timing? Right when he says, I bring you a message of great joy, he drops a security blanket. Because that's what it's about. All of a sudden, Linus got a new worldview, right? The world that he used to live in changed when he realized that a message of great joy for all the people in the world, a Savior, was born. I'll bet you've never heard of Gregory of Nazianzus, but he lived at around 370 A.D., and he was one of the early church fathers. And this was a time when the church was really debating, how could Jesus be both human and divine at the same time? And there was a big schism in the church, and there was this real push to get this thing cleared up, because people couldn't understand, how could Jesus be 100% man and 100% God? And they were leaning away because they were saying, listen, Jesus the man, I mean, he grew hungry and he needed to eat food. He grew weary and he needed to rest. He got fatigued or overwhelmed by emotion and he wept. And how could we reconcile that with things that the Apostle Paul wrote, such as this in Colossians 2:9, for in him, Jesus, all the fullness of deity dwells in bodily form. How could you reconcile those two things? And so Gregory argued that Jesus was not one person with two natures. He was just one person, and simultaneously those natures worked together. It wasn't one or the other, and he could experience everything according to whether it was his human nature or his divine nature. And so one of the big arguments that they used was the scripture in John 5:19, where Jesus said, therefore Jesus answered, and he was saying to them, truly, truly, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself unless it is something he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, these things the Son does also in like manner. And they were saying, if he is God and he's all powerful, how can he be so powerless that he himself could do nothing? And this was one of the arguments that they used. And Gregory argued that the phrase cannot, I cannot do something, he said that that word has several nuances to it. All right, it can mean the incapacity to do something, or it could mean the moral unsuitability to do something. In other words, he argued that Jesus could not do something that was at odds with the Father's will, for all that the Father has is the Son's, and all that the Son has is the Father. And that was recorded in Gregory's writing on God and Christ. And so when we look at Jesus, and when we celebrate this night tonight, which is the advent of Jesus coming into humanity, which is the greatest, you know, one of the greatest times in all of human history, we recognize that our minds probably won't fully ever understand the fact that Jesus was 100% God, 100% man, come into this world to bring salvation. But we do know that there was no one else in the history of humanity that fulfilled all of the Jewish prophecies, over 300, concerning the coming of Messiah. The odds get harder and harder when you start fulfilling a few of them. It gets harder to fulfill. In other words, like I've used this illustration before, but if I said, you know, I'm thinking of somebody here in the sanctuary, and you know, every time I add something to it, the odds get narrower, right? So if I say I'm thinking of somebody that, but it's a man, okay, so that disqualifies half of the people in this room. If I said that it's a man that's wearing a hoodie, well, that disqualifies a lot more people in this room out of the men. And if I said, well, it's somebody that's wearing a gray and blue hoodie, then that becomes really harder to fulfill. And then if I keep on going and going and going, I'm talking about Tuck over here, right? So not that he's the Messiah, but you get the understanding. So over 300, narrowing it down, it gets the odds get improbable that somebody could fulfill that, and yet Jesus fulfills every single one of those to a T. Not only that, but Jesus demonstrates his incredible power over evil in this world, and we all experience evil in this world, right? And Jesus, wherever he went, he was casting out demons, and even the demons testified of who he was. Hey, we know who you are, Jesus of Nazareth, the Holy One of God. Incredible. And then he demonstrates his power over the laws of nature. He walks on water, right? I mean, who's ever done that since then? He multiplied fish and bread to feed 5,000 people for one boy's lunch. He turned water into wine. He demonstrated his ability not only over the power of the demonic, but over power of nature. And then he demonstrates his incredible wisdom and teaching, making him the most famous man ever. No one ever spoke, not Buddha, not Confucius, not any other philosopher, Plato, Aristotle, any of these, no one ever spoke words like Jesus did. As a matter of fact, there's more books in the Library of Congress on Jesus of Nazareth than any other historical figure, the most popular person ever in history. And then, of course, he demonstrates his power over the great enemy, death, the one enemy that all of us at one time are going to have to face. No one here in this room tonight can escape. You can't beg, borrow, buy, plead your way out of having an encounter with death. And Jesus demonstrates his authority and power over even death by his self-resurrection back to life. And so he just shows up in history as the most phenomenal person ever. And when we put faith in him, when we choose to believe in him, we're born again and we receive forgiveness and we receive eternal life. And as the Bible says, we are called out of darkness into his marvelous light. And that's like Linus. That's a worldview. That's a change of worldview. I see life one way, and now I see life completely different, and it affects the way I live. Now, I'm saying all of this because it's so important, because in America and our history as a nation, one of our biggest failures as Christians is the failure to impact our society with a biblical worldview. And we see the worldview of our culture getting worse and worse and worse and farther from the things of God. And we're reaping the whirlwind because of it. The Bible says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, right? And we're walking away from that and we're seeing the results of that. And so a worldview, Dr. Joseph Kidder says, a worldview is the basic assumption and belief we hold about life that helps us interpret and engage in the world around us. Theologian Kevin Van Hooser said, a worldview is a way of thinking and living that pursues a way of life intended to achieve or maintain wellness in as many domains as possible, physical, financial, psychological, professional, social, and religious. In other words, a worldview impacts every part of our life, not just one part, but every part. And then lastly, sociologist Professor Diana Kendall says, whereas society is composed of people, culture is composed of ideas and behaviors and material possessions. Ideas and behaviors. Worldviews are shaped by a number of different things. They're shaped by parents. They're shaped by media. They're shaped by peers. It can be shaped by geography and education, outsiders. It can be shaped by culture, by nationality, and especially by the Bible. This gives us a Christian worldview, which is unlike any other worldview. It's unlike any secular worldview, that's for sure. And America is lacking a biblical worldview, that there is one God, that he's a loving God, that he sent his son to die for our sins. And it's a way of thinking that identifies and builds a biblical framework in society, to where ethics and morality and things become apparent where before they're not. Like, we live in a culture right now where there's no right, wrong, or good and evil. It's just like whatever, you know, do whatever you want. Everything is relative. And we need to have that biblical worldview that there are things that are not good for people to do, such as thou shalt not murder, right? Every society believes that that's a great thing to live by. Well, that's a biblical worldview that comes from the Bible. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not commit adultery. These are all things that the Bible gives us. Now, there are things that give us a biblical worldview that you can't like do away with these. And the first one is encountering the risen Christ. When you encounter the risen Christ, when you realize that God gave us a Savior, his name is Jesus, and when we throw ourselves into his arms and say, I have no other hope of eternal life outside of you, and we encounter the risen life, well, that begins to give us a different worldview of what life is all about, right? Because life is no longer just, you know, eat, drink, and be merry because tomorrow we die. Now life is no, death is just a change. It's just a graduation into a different life, and that life is eternal. And so encountering the risen Christ is so important. And it's not about what is truth. It's about who is truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father unless they come through me. That is truth. Whether we want to acknowledge it or not, that is the highest level of truth. We have no hope of heaven outside of Jesus' work on the cross for us. Right? That's the only way we get in. I can't get there and say, Lord, let me into heaven because I was a pastor for so many years. That isn't going to fly. I get there the same way every other person gets there, because I was a sinner and Jesus died for my sin. The other one is engaging in a faith community. You can't have a biblical worldview and never be connected to a family of faith, to a faith community where iron sharpens iron and where we help one another in this thing. And the last thing is the inculcating of scriptures. That word inculcating means to instill an attitude, idea, or habit by persistent instruction. In other words, we need instruction over and over and over and over again. That's why we need to belong to a faith community where we're hearing the scriptures explained and they become applicable to our life. And so these three things is what shapes and gives us a biblical worldview. You take one of these away and that weakens our ability to have a biblical worldview and to impact society. And if we're ever going to impact society, we need to really wrap our minds around this, because it behooves us. Jesus said, you know, you're light, and you don't put a basket over a light. You let it shine. And that's what we need to do. So we have to ask ourselves, you know, important questions. What does the Bible say about evil? You know, everyone always asks the question, if God is a loving God, then why? And you can fill in the blank. Why does such and such happen if God's a loving God? Well, we have to address the topic of evil. What does the Bible say about evil? What does the Bible say about eternal judgment? What does the Bible say about love and forgiveness? What does the Bible say about worldliness? What does it say about heaven or marriage or creation or family or finances or serving or eternal life or following Jesus? These are all huge topics. What does the Bible say about these things? Martin Luther, who is the great reformer, said, "The Bible is alive. It speaks to me. It has feet. It runs after me. It has hands. It lays hold of me." And that's where we need to get to, where the scriptures are really important, because they are the compass and the guiding light in our lives. Because otherwise, we're going to have a secular worldview when we need to have a biblical worldview. If we're going to be followers of Jesus, we can't have one foot in and one foot out, right? We have to have the scriptures guiding us and nurturing us and telling us how to live. Jesus said in John 17, verse 3, "This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent." How do we know him? We have that encounter with him. And then we engage with a faith community. And then we inculcate the scriptures. We hear it again and again. We're instructed and taught by the scriptures. Paul said this in 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creature, a new creation. All things have passed away, and behold, new things have come." Joy to the world, a new worldview has come. The biggest message that Jesus preached was the entrance of a kingdom, the kingdom of God, in whom he is the king. That's the worldview we need, that we're not citizens of America or South America or Africa or China or Russia. We are citizens of the kingdom of God, and that changes our worldview. A new worldview has come. Somebody has once said, and wisely said, if man needed knowledge, God would have sent an educator. If man needed technology, God would have sent an engineer. If man needed wealth, God would have sent a financial planner. If man needed mental health, God would have sent a psychiatrist. But man needed deliverance from the fatality of sin. And therefore, God sent a Savior. "Behold unto you this night, a Savior is born, Jesus, who will save you from your sins. I was blind, and now I see." What is that? That's a worldview. I was in darkness, and now my worldview has changed. I see things according to God's instruction in God's light. And when that happens, like Linus, we drop our blankets. Joy to the world. The Lord has come. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this Christmas Eve 2022, that you sent a Savior into the world to save us from our sins, and to give us a biblical worldview, to change our perspective, to change how we see everything. And Lord, when we line up with your worldview, when we line up with a kingdom worldview, we find that life is rich, It's full. It says the Apostle Paul says, I have learned to become content in any aspect I find myself in. Whether I'm abounding or whether I abase, I have contentment because of Christ and what he's done for me. And Lord, my prayer tonight for this congregation is that each person here tonight would face that question, what are you doing with Jesus of Nazareth? And they would wrestle that issue out. Lord, I pray that you would, that as you came 2,000 years ago in a manger, that you would come again in their hearts, and that we would be born again, and that our worldview would change, and we would rejoice in the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And it's his name we pray. And everyone said, amen and amen and amen. Hey, Merry Christmas. God bless you. And remember, the parking lot might be icy out there. Please walk slow. Have somebody hold your hand. And God bless you. We'll see you next Sunday. Merry Christmas.